Welcome back to another Stephen K. De Silva Ministries Prosperous Soul Minute. Still working on the name of this thing, you know. I don't know. Prosperous Soul Moment Minute. Well, it's too many minutes. I don't know. Anyway, welcome back. It's great to have you. And today we're going to talk a little further on the delicate subject of the tithe. But before I do, I have an upcoming trip. I wanted to let you know, for those of you who are interested in observing where and when Donna and I will be, we each have a website. Donna's is donnadesilva.com, I believe. Mine is stephenkdesilva.com. Both of those websites have an itinerary where you can see where we're traveling. And our next trip is with Donna, and I'm headed off to Meridian, Idaho. So if anyone there is interested in coming and watching or hearing a live session from Donna and myself, we'll be doing what's called Shifting Atmospheres. And this is at a church called Resurge Church. Now, the address is in Meridian, Idaho, but the best way to find them is their website, resurgenow.com. So go check that out, and they have a calendar, and you'll be able to see and probably register if they do that. I don't know, but it doesn't matter to me because we're going to Idaho. You know, I've been to Idaho, and I absolutely love that state, but I have never taught there. So this is a new territory for me, and I'm excited to go do that. So today we're going to talk about a little more of the subject on the tithe. And you'll remember I have said before that the tithe is a very emotional and a delicate subject. So I'm going to break it into a bunch of little pieces and just do a little bit each time as we go along. And what I wanted to do was begin with this question today is, should a church require a tithe for members? Okay. Well, I happen to be in a church that does, and it never really occurred to me. To be honest, it was not a matter to me because I tithed, and I was a member, and I thought, oh, yeah, I do that. So on the surface, I didn't ever really think about it, but that is not the place where some people are. They're in a place of wrestling inside. Is it right for a church to expect money to organize and run themselves? Is that biblical? And the short answer is yes, I believe it's biblical and right. But I wanted to explain my reasoning so you, my brother or sister, can manage your own thoughts and come to your own conclusion. So first off, I would say that if that person who is hearing this message about giving or about tithing, and they feel uncomfortable with that, or even if they're resisting or maybe avoiding membership because, wow, that's kind of a financial commitment, I'm not sure that feels good, I would first pose perhaps a different way of perceiving that information coming to you. Understand how brave it is for that leader to teach on the subject of money. It is so easy to take offense when someone is saying to you, I would like you to give to me. And it can be risky for those leaders. In fact, many leaders will avoid the subject altogether rather than risk the offense. So if you are in a situation where you're being asked or learning of an expectation in a community that you would tithe as a member, and you feel offense, I would ask you to change your way of thinking and think, well, they are approaching a delicate subject that I need to understand. So be happy with that, with your leader who is saying those kinds of cues to you. Now, the second thing is directly to the question of tithe and membership in a church, should those things go together? You know, the original intention of the tithe was actually not money. It was animals and fruits and grains. They would take these things, and the farmers and the ranchers would give a tenth of what they raised. If I had 10 cows, I would give one cow. The reason I would give that cow or that sheep would be so that it would be butchered and used in the sacrifices required under Judaic law. Now, we don't have those laws because we had one lamb for all sacrifice in Jesus, who was perfect, spotless, and blameless, and yet suffered the penalty on the cross, you know this, so that we would be paid for. So originally, the tithe was not money. Now, the Bible explains that you could give money in exchange of your animal, but you had to pay an extra amount to make up for that because the priests and the temple really wanted the animal or the grain or the grapes or something that was produced from the ground and offered one-tenth to God for the purification and washing of sins for the community. So now you have a situation where a church is saying, we don't take offerings to go butcher an animal and clean you because Jesus did all of that on the cross. And yet, we're asking you for the tithe. Is that right? Well, we all understand that the church is asking for support to operate. Now, probably your church uses a portion of that tithe or that offering that's taken on the weekend, on Sunday morning. They probably use some of that for supporting the poor and helping the widows and taking care of the needs of the community. But I think we all understand that probably most of that will go toward salaries in the church, paying the electric bill, making sure that the place is clean and has safe environment around it, nice furniture. So that's more operational than ministerial. Does that make sense? I would say this, both of those ideas are sacred. We don't have one when we help the needy that is sacred, but then pay a pastor that is secular. No, the whole thing is sacred. But the question boils down to, is it right for the tithe to be used for operations and for my church to expect it? So I would say this. I would say yes, based on an interesting verse. And I'll give you the address, Matthew 17, verse 27. Now the context is Jesus is talking about a tribute and the idea of an expectation placed upon the boys. Okay? And it's interesting to me that Jesus, this actually happens to Peter. Peter is somewhere in probably town. He's probably buying some bread and fish or whatever they're going to eat for dinner. He's doing the shopping. And somebody walks up to him and it says this. Now, I'll start in verse 24 of chapter 17 in Matthew. When they came to Capernaum, that was a city, those who collected the 2 drachma tax came to Peter and said, does your teacher not pay the 2 drachma tax? Well, let's stop right there and I'll explain. The 2 drachma tax was the half shekel fee that every adult male age 20 and older was expected to pay once a year. The expectation was that the money collected once a year from all these men who are 20 years and older would fund the operations like salaries, like cleaning, like all the things it takes to run the temple there. It would pay for that operational costs. Now realize the half shekel is different than the tithe. The tithe was supposed to come in animals and fruits and grains. But the half shekel tax was supposed to come in as money so that they could actually pay for some things, not the least of which was the care and feeding of the homeless. Okay, so they come to town and Peter is challenged in the street and asked, does Jesus do that? Does your leader do that tax? Can't you just see that happening to us today? And verse 25, Peter says, yes. And when he came to the house, Jesus spoke to him first, saying, what do you think, Simon? So it's interesting what's going on. Peter's like defending him, his leader, Jesus. He's saying, yeah, he pays it. But maybe he doesn't know because they haven't paid it ever. It's only once a year. So it's like, geez, I don't know. So they come home and Jesus picks up on this and says, what do you think, Simon? Which is Simon Peter, same guy. What do you think, Simon? From whom do the kings of the earth collect customs or poll tax? From their sons or from strangers? And when Peter said, from strangers. So now I'm in verse 26. Jesus said to him, the sons are exempt. Now, pause. What's going on is Peter doesn't know, but has answered, yes, Jesus does that because that's a rule, and I think Jesus follows all the rules. Then he comes back, and Jesus answers him, and he says, now, technically, what's happening, Peter, is they are asking us for money. And Jesus says, sons and strangers are different. Normally, strangers would pay that. We are sons. And the implication is we would not pay it. But let's read on verse 27. And this is the key verse for today's message. However, this is Jesus talking, so that we do not offend them, go to the sea and throw in a hook. Didn't even bait it. And take the first fish that comes up. And when you open its mouth, you will find a shekel. Take that and give it to them for you and me. What they were doing is, he said, you know what, Peter? The truth is, sons don't pay. But we will pay because it's been asked of us and we would not offend. Isn't that interesting? Now he goes one step further and he says, go pull the shekel out of the fish's mouth, which represents two halves, and use it to pay the half shekel tax for Peter and Jesus. And we presume Peter ran off and caught the fish and did all that. Isn't that awesome? But here's the thing. I believe when you're in a community, which is a family, this is a church fellowship, this is your people, your tribe. When you're there, and if you hear the leadership saying, you should give. We need you to support this organization, support the ministries and the good works that we do, and pay the tithe. The word tithe comes out of their mouth. That's because they are asking you, and they are communicating, this is the expectation of this community. We ask that you give it. They use the word tithe because it, for our culture, implies the idea of financial support that would be used for many reasons, for all the sacred things that a church is doing, helping the poor and the widow, paying the minister their living wage, maintaining the property, paying the property overhead, all of those things. So it comes down to this. We have biblical basis for Jesus to not offend. He paid a request that was on him as a member of that community. I think that's the biblical truth. And then if you're in a community, in a church body that says, in order to be a member, you need to donate to this ministry, do that. If that's your home, if they're your spiritual family, support them. Don't begrudge them or be upset or offended. Put off that offense and support our organizations that are doing good in the world. You know, there are so many organizations that do not do good. They posture themselves as if they will. But the truth is, our churches are serving Jesus as best they know. And I'm sure all of us would agree, no church is perfect. But we can agree that if we all serve as the body of Christ and use what we can to support the gospel of peace, then light will spread and not be driven back. Hey, there's my big message for the day on the tithe. Yes, I think it is proper and biblical for a church to require it if that's what the leadership have decided. All right? All right. Well, I'm going to get all ready and soon be on a jet plane with my beautiful wife and her faithful companions, Debbie and Dawn, and we're going to go land in Meridian, Idaho, and see what good things we can do in Jesus' name. Pray for us if you would, and I'll pray for you right now. Father in heaven, I ask you to bless every home and every giver in this community of prosperous soul. Father, you would build in us a cheerful giver anointing, that we would be generous and wise in how we sow. I pray this, and for those who need a breakthrough, I ask for that right now in their hands. You would bring a solution, whether it's financial, physical healing, or some spiritual need they have. Deliver it in your name to your own glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, guys, we're all done. I'm going to take a little quick chat here. If you want to bounce, please move on your way. I'm just going to say hello to my friends who's watching. Hello, me. Thank you so much for that comment. And Claudio Navas, my brother. It's good to see you on here, my friend. Here's Marcus Jewell with a strong opinion that tithing isn't biblical with the new covenant. Marcus, I appreciate your comment, but you're wrong. If you want to see my argument, go check out my volume 3 of Prosperous Soul. I'll write a book on the subject eventually. Technically, shaving hairs, I could see your position. All right? But it's not truth and it's not sound. I'm sorry, my friend, if that offends you, but that's the truth. Here is Aaliyah. Thanks. You're welcome, girlfriend. Thanks so much for the comment. And here is our sister in Hawaii saying hello. God bless you, Vicky. I'm going to sign off, and I'll see you guys next week. Well, if I'm on the plane, I may have to pre-record. I don't know. But my hope is I'll see you here next week, next Monday, same time. God bless you guys. Bye-bye. Hey, thanks for watching. I'm Stephen K. De Silva, and you're probably wondering, why have I never heard this information before? Well, now you can by going up into this corner and subscribing to this channel. Or you can go to this corner and watch the next video. There is tons of information I'm giving you. Go check it out and go deeper. Or better yet, go to the link below and go check out my website. I've got some free stuff on there. Go get that and go see lots of resources so you can finally master your money. Hey, I gotta go record another video. I'll see you soon. Bye.